Welcome to Shrink to Shrink, a side view on the films with Dr. Colleen Mullen and Courtney Calkins, bringing lessons learned from the big screen into our own lives. He's not a doctor, he just has a master's degree.
Well, that's quite an intro. Yes, I just have, but I get to hang out. I get to hobnob with Dr. and folks. Welcome to the show.
Hi, Courtney.
Hello,
good
hello.
Good to see you again.
I'm feeling just wiped out, man. I'm demolished.
Are you? Do you feel like picking up the pieces of your life?
I feel like tearing everything apart. I don't know.
And then putting it back together.
Well, I haven't gotten that far. I just feel like tearing things apart.
Oh, you're there.
Yeah.
Well, maybe by the end of the episode, you'll want to put it all back together.
Maybe I'll want to understand it. You know, just understand my own life and figure out what's going on with me. You know, I don't know. But
maybe.
That is what is on tap for
right.
Today. We're talking about Demolition, and you hadn't seen it before, right?
No, I hadn't actually even heard of it. So, and it's a Jake Gyllenhaal movie, and I was surprised that I hadn't heard of it because I'm a bit of a fan of him. So Demolition is the movie, and it has so many good, great themes, really, around relationships, around loss, around putting the pieces of your life back together and being in touch with your emotions. So I'm really looking forward to our chat today.
I was looking it up, and there's a stress scale. I try to remember exactly who, you know, made the stress scale, but it talks about the different events of people's lives, and I guess objectively looks at what their actual, the level of stress that they're experiencing. Okay, so like number one, you know, for 100 points, this is the number one thing: death of a spouse. And that's what we got here in this episode.
That's right.
And even then the way she dies, I mean, let's just jump right into that
to that first clip.
Yeah, and because you never know. We always think that we're just going to live until we, you know, die of old age or whatever, but it doesn't always happen like that, and that's how this movie opens.
Have you looked at the refrigerator yet?
Huh? The refrigerator?
Yeah, the box in our kitchen that keeps things cold.
Yeah. No, I mean, what about it?
It's leaking. It's been leaking for 2 weeks.
Refrigerator's leaking.
Please don't do that thing where you repeat part of what I said so I'll think you're paying attention.
I'm not doing anything. The refrigerator's leaking. I didn't notice.
Can't you just fix it? Your father gave you those tools.
I have tools?
Yes, from 2 Christmases ago. Not my chair. Not my problem. Is that what you say?
And that's where it begins and ends for her, really.
Yes. Except for a few little ghost-like appearances through the movie. That is the end of her acting there. And that was quite an impactful start to a movie, right? And, you know, and I think we've all been there, you know. We're just having mundane conversations with our partners and nitpicking about stuff at times. And you just think, I don't know, I was left going, you know, why do we need to waste so much time on that stuff? Just, there's so many much more interesting, better, life-filling things to talk about. And I guess sometimes we have to talk about the leaky fridge, but, you know, that scene just really highlighted how, as you said when we set it up, you know, you just think life goes on the same way every day, day in, day out, especially once you've got your partner, you've got your career, you think, oh, okay, this is how it goes, and you really don't know when it could all just go away.
Yeah, you know, every time, it drives my wife crazy, and it has ever since I was in the position where I dropped the kids off at school, and so every time I drop them off, I say, see if I don't die. And
Courtney,
the kids go, see if I don't die. Yeah, see, you have the same reaction my wife does. And I'm like, but it's true. See if I don't die. All right, love you. See you. Bye. You know, but that's a real thing. You know, you gotta,
yes.
We don't treat life like, you know, it's going to go on forever. So that way, you know, I don't want to leave things undone. Now, I'm not perfect or whatever. And it's actually turned into something, you know, like some people have their mantras or whatever. They can just repeat them. They stop meaning what you thought what they initially started out meaning. So even that with See If I Don't Die doesn't carry the same meaning as when my wife overhears it. She's like, why do you say that? Mm-hmm. I said, because it's real. You know, if we're taking stock. But I think that's one of the things that I think people struggle with. And I don't think it happened so much. Oh, it did happen for the mom in this movie. But where you think back about, the last conversation we had, yes. I didn't like it.
Right. And what we miss in that first scene is that there's a little bit of chatting also about why she's not speaking to her mother. And they have this dinner planned in a couple of days. And she said, well, I'll just work it out with her then. But they had chosen not to speak to each other for a little bit.
Yeah, over petty things. And, yes. You know, and in hindsight, all of it's petty, right? Because you could have a really good friend or an ex or a whatever, even an enemy that you see on Facebook. Mm-hmm. You know, all of a sudden they posted they got cancer and you're like, well, maybe I wasn't the biggest fan of theirs, but I certainly don't wish death and evil and destruction on people.
Certainly. Yeah.
So this event creates a what sets up for the rest of the movie to be, you know, Jake Gyllenhaal's journey after his wife passes away and how he kind of constructs his life, because it doesn't seem to quite make sense.
Right. Well, and you know, of course, the crash demolishes his life, demolished the car, demolished his wife, demolished his life, and then the theme where it literally becomes demolition of things in his life comes out a little bit later in a few more scenes from now.
Yeah, and that's one thing I wanted to get to you was, you know, when we get to that about tearing things apart to make them better. I don't know. Well, this in order to get the full setup, we have almost a 3-minute clip that I've chunked mm-hmm. together. I've pulled 3 or 4 pieces and squeezed them all together because I want to get the setup because it's central to what we're going to be discussing here today. And here it is.
Dear Champion Vending Company, comma. This letter is in regards to a poor vending experience at St. Andre's. In regards to vending machine number 714, located in the intensive care unit of St. Andre's Hospital. I put 5 quarters in your machine and proceeded to push B2, which should have given me peanut M&Ms, period. Regrettably, it did not. I found this upsetting as I was very hungry, and also my wife had died 10 minutes earlier. I'm not saying that was your fault. We were in a car accident. Remarkably, I escaped without a scratch. I'm not trying to dramatize my claim. I just want to be thorough. Maybe I should start from the beginning. I just mean that I commute. I catch the 7:15 out of White Plains. It's pretty much the same crowd during the week. John works a ground crew at Yankee Stadium. The first time we met, he asked what I did, and I told him.
Retail mattresses.
Retail mattresses? That's amazing.
I don't know why. Just popped into my head. I avoided him after that because I couldn't stand his hot coffee breath.
Excuse me.
I think he knew. I never thought I'd be one of those people who carried a briefcase. It always reminds me of carrying a lunchbox to school. Do they still make those? Julia's father is a founding partner at the investment firm I work at. Nepotism in its truest form. He started grooming me when I was 27. It's a small firm, but we handle quite a bit of money. I don't want to say how much because I think it would be inappropriate.
Just look over where the money is.
Okay, it's $6 billion. Emerging markets, infrastructure, power plants, telecom, SeaWorld, windshield wipers. You name it. Doesn't matter what industry. We buy it cheap, we sell it for a bundle. But none of it's real.
Yeah.
Nothing to hold in my hands.
Yeah.
It's all just numbers. Computer codes being transferred electronically through the air. I met Julia at a party. A mutual friend said she thought I was hot. I returned a compliment. We had sex about 3 hours later. I don't think Phil liked me that much at first. I grew up in Jersey. I didn't come from money. And I puked on the ice sculpture at our engagement party. Also, he told me once,
I don't like you, Davis.
Julie was a nice girl, a good person. She worked with special needs children. She snorted when she laughed and cried every time they showed footage of the towers falling. Other than that, I don't think I knew who she really was. She always said I didn't pay attention. Perhaps you'll find this information irrelevant in your deliberation of my refund, but I think you deserve the whole story. Sincerely, Davis C. Mitchell.
So, whoa, two of those. So that's
where the long clip, two explosions.
Yeah, that's where it all starts to that's where it sets up, right? This whole movie is almost his journal or his diary to the Champion Vending Company, or at least the first half.
Right, and I think that we should also talk about, like, right before we get there. So this happens, obviously, we hear that happens at the hospital, but he's not showing any grief. And it almost appears like he doesn't care that his wife died. And the only inkling that you get that there's an emotional struggle going on for him in this early part of it is these letters to the vending company. And, you know, and here we can hear how, I mean, the initial clip, I think, was actually like 6 minutes long. So that's only half of the storytelling in the letter that he did. And to me, watching it, I just thought, oh, he really feels it, but he doesn't know it yet, because he's so disconnected from his emotions that he just thinks, well, I just need to get my money back. This company owes me something for that day that this didn't work on this significant day in my life when I was in grief and when my wife died. Not even, he wouldn't say I was in grief. He would say the day my wife died, I deserve a refund.
Yeah, and what was interesting because he's a pretty functional guy. He's a normal person. And yes, at least living in life, and you know, he has a functional job and a house and a, you know, just he kind of has gone through life without being able to connect at all. And this one thing, this number one on the stress scale, right? Death of a spouse, 100 points. If anything's going to get an emotion or a response out of any, you know, human, it's going to be this. And this movie shows that at this point, he's got nothing, but he doesn't even recognize really that he's got nothing because everyone's looking at him going, you know, are you okay? He's like, yeah, I'm fine. Pretty much fine.
Right. Right. He shows up to work the day after, you know, the day after the funeral, or, you know, and when things are still extremely raw. And of course, his father-in-law owns the company and people are just shocked that he's there. And he's like, hey, what's up? Like, what's the problem? You know? And I think, Courtney, when you were talking about that stress scale, do you have that around? I'm wondering, like, what are some of the other things that you can tell us about that are on that stress scale? Because one of the things I think both you and I probably deal with our clients so much, and just in our own life, like some days I have to do my own inventory and go, what kind of stresses am I dealing with? Because, man, I feel out of sorts. And I think it's easy to have a lot of things that are high impact stressors and not really notice them.
Yeah. Okay. So I think there's 43 things on the stress scale, and they're each ranked as far as, you know, points, how many, but I'll just go through the first 10. Okay. So as we said, death of a spouse, you get 100 points on your stress scale.
Woohoo, 100 for that one.
And then for divorce is second with 73.
All right.
Three, marital separation, 65. Mm-hmm. So marital separation and divorce are only 8 points apart.
But the top three are relationship and spouse, like partner spouse related. Isn't that something?
Mm-hmm. Number four, jail term, 63. So that's less than divorce. Would you rather go to jail or get divorced? Apparently the stress scale says it's easier to go to jail.
And that personal experience, I'd much rather get divorced 10 times over than go to jail. Thanks.
I know, that's what I'm thinking. Don't take away all my freedoms. Although some people, maybe when they get divorced, they feel like they're getting let out of jail. I don't know. I'm sure it's subjective. Okay, number five, death of a close family member is 63, so same as a jail term. Mm-hmm. And then personal injury or illness, 53. These are all stress points that you score. And then this is interesting. This is our first what would be considered a positive one, positive stress. Marriage, 50 points. Just 50 points just for getting married.
And that's something significant to talk about too. Like you can, I bet buying a house is on there and getting a good job and all that stuff is on the stress scale, because not all stressors are negative. Like things that impact how we function day to day are not always bad things. Something, having a baby is another one, right? Mm-hmm. Is that on the list?
I only kept the top 17, but pregnancy is number 12.
Yeah.
We've got fired at work, 47 points. This is interesting, another positive one. Marital reconciliation, you get 45 points, stress points for. Mm-hmm. So I don't know if that counts the whole thing or just when you guys actually finally decide to get back together. I don't know. This one you wouldn't really think of. Retirement, 45 points on the stress scale. Mm. That's number 10.
A lot of adjustment, though, at that point in life.
Yeah, and I'll just bounce around. We've got pregnancy is 40 points. Sex difficulties is 39 points. Change in financial state. Interesting the way that's phrased. That's 38 points. That's a plus or a minus, isn't it?
That's right. You could get a $50,000 raise or a $50,000 loss, and it's going to cost the same amount of points.
Yeah, it's the same. There's a lot of stress. And then death of a close friend is 37. And business readjustment is 39. So those are some of the top. I'll link the scale in the description so people can kind of go on. And you can actually take the stress test on your own.
And is this the one where the highest number is, like once you reach around 200 or something, you're really off the charts? Or does it give you a meter kind of? A grading point.
It does, but I didn't go in and take it. But you can go in and take it. It's a simple yes or no. Have you experienced this? I think in the past. So, needless to say, our hero here, Davis, is experiencing number one. Right. That's number one. 100 points. Death of a spouse. You know, I think we'll talk about the stages of grief at some point because you have that. And but interesting, in that earlier clip, I cut out a part where he was lying to the guy on the train. Just a guy who he was sharing the train with. Right. He just told him he worked at a different job for no particular reason other than he just didn't tell him the truth. So in this next clip, he goes back and he talks to the guy again. And I find it really interesting that Davis, this has troubled Davis. Every time he sees this guy on the plane or train, he avoids him and doesn't want to talk to him because he lied to him in the past and doesn't want to continue it. And then he decides, I'm going to actually tell this guy the truth. And if you watch the way the conversation goes, the guy is relatively unaffected. You know, he's like, I don't care about you, Davis.
Well, and he also had his own story of losing his job. So you're going
to
play the clip.
Yeah, I'll play it. But I just wanted to point that out, that it's like he didn't go, man, I've really been thinking about that. Why did you lie to me? Just listen to how it goes.
And of course, the train incident.
I feel like I should tell you something. I'm in finance. I don't know why I told you that I worked in the mattress business. I guess I didn't expect to see you every day for 5 years. You think I'm a dick?
I don't work for the Yankees anymore. I fired over a drainage issue in the visitor's bullpen. I work security now at a parade of shoes in Midtown. Fucking job. Little prick of a boss. He's 30 years younger than me. Just want to go in there and smash his little prick face.
Jeez. I didn't love my wife. I know it's sad to say, but now that she's gone, I don't even feel sad or pain or hurt.
Well, what do you feel?
I couldn't tell you why I did it.
Okay, so in that clip, you know, that last ringing of the bell that we heard was another sign that we see that Davis is not dealing with his emotions. He feels something, but the guy says, well, what do you feel? And you can't see it, but he reaches up and grabs the emergency brake and runs off the train. And there's a scene then that he gets picked up by his parents from the police because they just don't know what's going on with him. And they hear his wife dies and they're like, man, this guy needs a little help. So, but the story of telling stories when you meet someone else. I mean, I don't know about you. Like, I've been there. I don't always say I'm a therapist, or at least when I was in graduate school, I didn't. Now I do. I don't care. I can own it. But but when I was in graduate school, and especially when I was dating, you know, like I usually tried not to talk about what I did just out of avoiding the questions of, oh, so how are we doing in this relationship stuff? Or, you know, like on the third date or something, you know? I think we do it in little ways too, giving fake names at the coffee shop, just because we don't want to have to sit there and spell our name 20 times, mm-hmm. you know? So I don't know, Courtney, what do you think about that? You ever give a fake story about what you do for some reason?
And maybe not so much about what I do, but I'll inflate different pieces of, not inflate, but just not be completely accurate when I'm talking to someone who I know this conversation is not going anywhere and they're not my life. So if they're not a significant person, like if I'm on a plane, I would just tell a story and I wouldn't give the whole complete details because it's inconsequential to the mm-hmm. to the story or how it goes, and it's just too many words, and I could hear other questions coming in if I elaborate on that part. So I'll just kind of skirt certain things. But there is something really cool about being able to talk to someone who you know has no significance in your life.
Yes, and I'll say I get, maybe it's just my own nature, I get curious about people. So for as much as I might not want to go into things all the time, I get curious about the other person. But I have it just reminded me of a funny experience. So I went in for this exploratory medical procedure a couple months ago, and I called the day before to do the pre-op check-in, and the woman's taking the inventory of who I am, where I live, all this stuff. She said, oh, what do you do? And I said, oh, I'm a therapist. Well, let me tell you, by the end of the conversation, she was like, do you mind if I ask you a question? So then she did, and I kid you not, the woman came to me when I was getting woken up from the anesthesia and said, oh, hey, it's me from the phone call, and hey, I'd love for you to come and speak at one of these things over at the women's club. And I'm like, huh? Like, I was literally under anesthesia, and I would not recognize her if she came up to me today, and it was the strangest thing. And I thought, oh my gosh, like, this is why sometimes it's better to just say you do something other than what you do, because somebody will have some question about it. And if you give a fake job, they can just ask you a question, you say, you know what, I really don't know that.
Yeah.
And it won't matter.
I think everybody runs into it, right? If you meet a hairdresser, you go, oh, well, how do you think they did? How's this color? Do you like this? Or if, I work with attorneys. So attorneys are like, look, every time I say I'm an attorney, you know, it's either to the jokes or, oh, I got a question.
And I learned growing up, I worked for my father's law firm through my 20s. But growing up with him, I'd be at the office with him late night, and after a certain time, he would answer the phone because he would think like my mom was calling to kind of say, oh, bring home some milk or whatever. And he'd answer the phone. But if it was a business call, and he owned the firm and he could answer any question he wanted, but he would answer the phone. So he'd say, blah, 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 they're looking for the attorney. He'll say, oh, I'm sorry, I'm just the cleaning man. I thought it was my wife. Call back in the morning. Right. And that would be the end of it.
Yeah. I don't want to work. Don't put me to work right now.
Yeah. I'm not getting caught in this call.
Yeah, exactly. Because that makes it a lot easier. But I don't think that's what's happening, like in this Davis situation. I think he's just trying this out. He doesn't think he loved his wife.
No, and that's what happened. The death happens, and I truly believe from watching the full film, I don't think he was as out of touch with his life as the death makes him feel. What happens is that the crash happens, the death happens, the loss happens, and he does what's called compartmentalizing. He doesn't realize it, but it's a trauma reaction. And he puts the feelings are so uncomfortable that his mind just kind of puts them up in a box in a closet in his brain, and it doesn't let him access it. So instead of feeling everything or even feeling like anything, he feels nothing, and he feels very numb. And that's an extreme trauma reaction because he went through an extreme trauma. And in fact, now we even have a diagnosis called complicated grief, because he, and I believe it's an official diagnosis now, I know it was in the works for a while, but, and that just means that, like, sometimes in life we expect things to happen. Like, you expect to grow old with your spouse, and at some point one of you will die before the other, but you don't expect it to happen at 35 driving down the road on the way home from work. And so when something happens that's out of the norm, or somebody loses a child, or there's a plane crash, whatever, some kind of loss that is not the expected life stage loss becomes a complicated grief process, which means that although what we know of like the five stages of grief, and they go all over the place, and we can talk about that for a second too if you want, but complicated grief just has added layers of complexity that we don't really even understand fully yet, because we realize, though, that it is a different grief. So the five stages of grief are denial, anger, bargaining, depression, and acceptance. And the good thing and bad thing I think about grief is that it doesn't go in order. So some days, like, you think, okay, well, I'm really angry. Like, I can't believe that this happened. Why did this person have to die? All that stuff. And then the anger often leads to depression. But then you might have a day where you're like, oh, but I get it. Like, they're really gone. But then maybe an anniversary date will come up, and then you're back in denial and go, man, I really can't believe they're gone again. I'm so sad again. And so grief is like this cycle of going up and down and backwards in adjusting to the loss.
I've taught the five stages. I just say DABDA, D-A-B-D-A, which is not a word, but it helps me remember, you know, denial, anger, bargaining, depression, and acceptance. And as I've talked with a lot of people about it, the first one, denial, you know, we would say that Davis in this stage is in denial. Although I prefer shock. He's in shock. He doesn't deny that his wife is dead.
Right.
But it's almost like an emotional denial.
Yeah. And shock is a great word, right? Because that's that trauma too, right? So, and that causes his like automatic response was to not, like, it's just gone. And so he doesn't feel anything, which is part of the denial, right? He's not even angry. And that's why like the clues that come through in these letters to the, because there are multiple letters through the movie to the vending company. You see his emotions come through and things that he says, but he will then put the letter away and just not like go back to being in a place of not feeling.
On the last one, acceptance, I modify that one too. I say more of an acknowledgement, meaning that, you know, are you going to accept that your wife died? Well, I accept it as a fact. But I think that if I put the word acknowledge on it, it's like I acknowledge it. It still hurts. I'm still pissed. I still am sad. Yes. I still cry. But it's there. I'm not like, because acceptance feels like there's a finality. Like, okay, I've reached acceptance. I'm done with my grief.
Right. And that's why, you know, I was making reference to what we call anniversary reactions or different significant dates in your life. Like every time their birthday comes around or your wedding anniversary, things like that can bring it back up. So there's that, I like that acknowledgement, because acceptance is not a final place to be. And because when we have things that remind you could walk in a room and smell your wife's perfume, and there is the grief again, it can feel like it just happened, but it was 5 years ago. You still have a bit of kind of going through that again, whether it lasts 5 minutes or another 5 months, you can get triggered back into it, and it can feel like it just happened.
You know how we were just talking about that stress scale. I think grief exists on a scale also, meaning, and I tell as an example, I think we go through the grief process all the time in different situations. Like I make it really petty, right? Because so we have the death of a spouse. We're all going to look at that as we go through this episode. But when I'm telling it to a group, I'll say, all right, so let's say I order a pay-per-view movie, right? I'm all ready and I flip to the channel and it's not there. And I'm like, no, it can't be. I know I paid for it and everything. Okay, so denial, right? And
then the equivalent statement of, I just paid for it. I can't believe I can't see it. Like when somebody says, well, I just saw him yesterday.
So then I'm like, all right, I'm pissed. You know, now you got my money. I saw the charge on my account. There's my anger. So denial, anger. And then I'm like, well, maybe I should have just called it in, or I shouldn't have done it on the internet, or I should have done it through my cable box. That's bargaining, right? Mm-hmm. So denial, anger, bargaining. And then I'm sitting there and I'm like, there's no way I'm going to get this money back. And I've got my popcorn and I've got my soda, and I'm ripped off. This is not right, you know? And so I'm just down. And then at the end I go, all right, you know what? I'll just put on Back to the Future, 'cause that's something I have a DVD of, and I just accept it. Right. So grief could be just over this little thing. And we're all doing it all the time, you know, 'cause we all have expectations and things where we're let down. And I teach that to people so that they just kind of understand when they're watching somebody else and going through some type of loss, as minor as it might be just their car got keyed, right? You know, could be any of that. All that would apply. And so just watching people and tracking people through it, and not kind of engaging in each one of the phases, but just kind of watching other people as they process, I feel like that helps a lot. I know it helps me a lot when I understand those phases of grief.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Recognizing what you're going through is one of the best ways to get to a place where it doesn't have to hurt so bad, especially with grief.
And you're a therapist, so I don't know. I've never heard of what Davis's father-in-law, the advice he gives him in this clip, but maybe you can tell me if you've heard it.
There's something else, dearest vending company. I couldn't take it 1 second longer. Damn refrigerator was leaking. Now, I wouldn't say I'm handy by any means. Mechanically retarded would be closer to the truth. But Phil said it himself. If you want to fix something,
you have to take everything apart
and figure out what's important.
What'll make you stronger? Repairing the human heart is like repairing an automobile. Just examine everything. Then you can put it all back together.
Is it?
Courtney, so you're asking me if I've heard that before? Not necessarily like that. You know what it made me think of? That theme of like, more like the military kind of theme of you've got to, like, about getting torn down to kind of become what they need of you. So people often describe their boot camp experiences that way.
So breaking them down and only back to build them back up.
But sure, you can piece everything apart. It's like psychotherapy, right? Like you go back to the beginning and you start pulling everything out that could possibly influence why you're thinking the way that you're thinking today. So then you become aware of that, and then you can kind of have a new perspective, which essentially would be putting it back together and saying, this is how my understanding of that now. It doesn't necessarily mean that it is repaired and healed by his basic statement to tear it apart to put it back together. Just means that you'll understand it is what I'm taking away from that, not that it necessarily is healed and fixed. Although he uses the word fixed, I would differ on that.
Okay.
What about you, Courtney?
I was jumping all over in my head when you're like, okay, psychotherapy, but you're talking about psychoanalysis, right? The
yes.
Freudian. And then yes. When you put it all back together, I was thinking of the narrative therapy where you kind of restory. You restory your life, looking at it with additional information or additional perspective. Yeah.
They call it creating your new narrative.
Right. And so I could see it like that, but it's funny, and it kind of points out something that I think maybe lost. Well, I don't think it's lost on folks who watch this. He takes that metaphor of pulling things apart literally. So he kind of gets stuck on this concept that, all right, well, I need to take things apart and I want to understand them. And he takes apart the stall at work, and he takes apart the refrigerator, and he takes apart his whole house, you know, and I guess that's just his, whatever, you use another psychiatric term, you know, sublimation or whatever, I don't know. But it's some defense mechanism that is helping him to feel like he's actually doing something about the grief.
And there's an extreme nature to it as well. There's another scene where he goes and finds a construction site where guys are demolishing a house, and he does end up demolishing his own house literally with a bulldozer and hammers and breaks it apart, but he has this extreme nature to feeling anything. And you see it's one of the few times in the movie where you see him actually like feel something, whether it's just screaming and anger and hitting with the hammer, or at one point he steps on a nail, and for as much as it's painful, he's like almost cheering it on that he's feeling something. And it's such extreme and need for overstimulation, just kind of highlighting how absolutely numb he is, that it takes stepping on a nail or demolishing his house for him to actually feel anything at that point. And he thinks it's because his wife's death has just highlighted the fact that he's not in touch with his emotions. And really, the wife's death has forced him to not be in touch with his emotions because it's too painful.
Yeah, and I think we see that in different cases, like with when people are cutting, right? A lot of times people are like, I just don't feel anything. And then I cut and I feel something.
Mm-hmm.
So people have different ways of kind of pulling out their own. You know, it's interesting because, you know, if I hit my hand with a hammer, that hurts. That's a feeling. but it's if I hit my hand with the hammer and then I go, dang it, I can't believe these stupid hammer people, or why did I do that, or why wasn't I looking, or da, 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 you know, then it becomes like an emotion and a pain, right? So there are emotionalizers. I was talking to Swanee, who works in surgery all the time, and he says he sees people come out and he calls them sufferers. He says they're both in the same amount of pain, but the sufferers are moaning and groaning and whining and complaining, and yet the other person next to him would be in the same amount of pain, but they're not emotionalizing it. And so it's almost like, I could see how the two are related, like that physical pain and having emotion and feeling something, physically feeling something, which leads to emotionally feeling something. And that's where he's caught. Davis is caught in all of this. He's like, well, I want to feel something, but not in my heart, in my body.
Right. So it goes to the physical, which taps into the emotional, and it's safe. Which is what, when you started talking about like cutting, and for people that know that behavior, even that don't, there's this phenomenon of people that will, behavior phenomenon that people cut on themselves as a way of relieving emotional pain, so they go to the physical. And it's a highly addictive process for people, and it's really a tough behavior to break, but it's so compelling for them because it does relieve the emotional pain, because they get to focus everything in and zero in on the physicality of it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and like you said, it's a hard one to break, because it's a lot like an addiction, right? If you drink drugs
addictive.
Or addicted to whatever, it could be, I'm not even chemical substances, addictive to exercise, and you want to go run these 100-mile things, and all of a sudden you're into all your fitness. If there's an avoidance nature to it, if there's a motivating factor to be away from or apart from or not in touch with part of yourself or part of your own life experience, then you're looking at an addictive behavior that is taking the place of something else. But, you know, we've talked a lot about how people grieve differently, and it's exemplified here in the next scene where the mom, they're having a dinner party, Davis with his in-laws, and he has a conversation there. And the other thing, just as soon as I say that, Davis had no friends. He had no personal family. He only had her family. He starts to develop this friendship throughout the course of the movie, but he really didn't have any, you know, nobody calling him saying, hey, let's go get some pizza. I know you're probably alone now. You got that big, beautiful house. You have nothing to do. No support.
It's a good point. It's a good point that really was not highlighted through the movie, but that was a great observation that, and it could have been that just like so many other couples, you know, maybe the wife was the social connection, because that is how a lot of couples are. And with her gone, people are just grieving. And also, though, we also have to look at people don't like to approach people who are in grief. And I know if you've ever lost anybody, it can feel like your friends abandon you, and really they just have no idea what to say. So all of a sudden, the fact that you might talk to them every couple of weeks, those every couple of weeks feel like lifetimes. And you're like, how come nobody's calling me? Why won't people do that? And I've talked so many times when people have gone through significant grief or significant trauma experiences that they feel very abandoned by their friends because nobody knows what to do. And if they were very good friends with the circumstances of their loss, you know, the person who's gone, they're also in grief as well. And everybody's trying to process and deal, and it can be very isolating. So I don't know if we really know if he had nobody or if it's just one of those things where grief happens and people just stay away.
But I had a boss of mine, partner really, at work, and her son passed away. And so we talked about it a lot and talked about the reactions of people and how they responded. And I think it's important for everybody to know that's listening that when someone's going through that and you ask them, say, I'll be here, whatever you need. You know, all you have to do is ask. Most people don't ask. So you just kind of got to, and that's why the beauty of taking over a meal or something like that kind of forces you in that front door, and you'll know whether that person needs to talk or needs to be alone, but at least you're there. You're not calling them and saying, what do you need? Because we just covered it. They're in shock and denial. They're not in touch with themselves. They don't know what they need. They don't know it. So, you know, to just say, I'll be here. I will bet if you went back over all the other, you know, if you talk to people who feel abandoned in those moments of crisis, if you actually were able to record the final conversations or the most recent conversations they've had with their friends, almost everybody's saying, whatever you need, I'm here, I'll be there. And then they go away and leave him alone. So they really don't get in touch with him. So, okay, so here's everybody grieving differently.
Some people wallow through their grief. My wife, she cooks.
This is delicious, Margaret. What is it?
Did Julia tell you what we were fighting about? I bought her these bath towels, and she didn't like them. So she took them back without telling me. And we hadn't spoken for 3 days.
Excuse me.
That scene, for as short as it is really significant to show how, as you said, how people deal with their grief differently. Because Davis is just cut off. The father is outwardly throughout the movie talking about how the loss of his daughter. And the mother can't answer the question and stay present because she's so stuck in it and says, do you know why we weren't talking? Let me tell you about that. And she has that like survivor's remorse. It's a different, I'm using the term a little off, but just the fact that she's alive and her daughter is dead, she's having regrets that she let this petty argument go into choosing not to speak to her because now she can't get any more time with her. So she's having that regret of, I can't believe that I won't get to talk to my daughter again.
That this was the last conversation. A lot of people get stuck there, you know, instead of looking at the years and years they had of positive relationship and, you know, sure you have your gripes at each other and then you get over it and get through it. Mm-hmm. But she's stuck on that last thing.
Right. As if her daughter will have died thinking poorly of her mother. Like, I think that's why people get stuck in that, because you want to have, and even when we have a parent who's elderly and passing away, people sometimes don't want to go and see their parent in that last stage because they say, I don't want to remember them like that. And it's like, well, are you not going to remember them for the other 50 years that you had with them? But people get stuck on that's going to be the image, and that will far surpass anything else that I've ever experienced with them. And that's where mom is in this movie. She's going, I can't believe that was the last conversation. And she is stuck there as if that will be the last, like her crowning glory as a mom is that she stopped talking to her daughter 3 days before she died. And that was it. Like, it's a horrible thought for her to have, but certainly that's where she's living in her emotions right now.
And dad starts off, well, father-in-law starts off by saying, you know, some people wallow in their grief. My wife cooks. I don't think there's anything wrong with staying distracted or mm-hmm. staying busy. I think that's one of the reasons, like when my partner lost her son, she came back to work relatively soon because she said, I could just stare at my four walls if I wanted. And so she came back, you know, in part because she needed to just kind of get out and do something and not just sit in her grief all the time. So it wasn't a, you know, like that kind of distractive addiction type thing, but mm-hmm. it wasn't wallowing either. So there's a good balance right. You have to do there.
Right. And different from like compartmentalizing, you know, like your partner came back to work and it probably made her feel good to be back in touch with people and in the role that she plays with them and feeling fulfilled in a way that, right, sitting at home was going to be devastating for her and being reminded of all the loss. So she was not out of touch with what was going on. Davis was out of touch. Davis says, I don't know what the problem is. Like, why should anybody worry that I'm at work today? Whereas your partner sounds like she's aware, she knew I'm doing this so that I can cope. And I think when we talk about people dealing differently with grief, there are families where somebody will die and like one person will be able to tell a joke about the person at the funeral and kind of have a good laugh and feel good about like, hey, so-and-so would have really enjoyed that story. Another person will not even be able to say their name out loud. They're in such pain. Another person will be crying and wailing the whole time. And that could just be three siblings in a family, right? And everybody deals with the grief differently. Grief is this thing that we can say these are the stages, but it almost never looks the same for anybody across even families and people who you think would have similar makeups and how they're dealing with things.
So Davis makes connection with the complaint department of the vending machine, and his connection is this lady. And they kind of weave themselves into each other's lives. Similar dysfunction, different mm-hmm. situation. She's got a kid, and he kind of ends up going over there and talking to her, but she's got a boyfriend. And so they have a conversation, the only conversation really, about his now deceased wife with this Champion Vending or whatever it is, company mm-hmm. Consumer representative. And here it is.
Julia loved the ocean. We used to spend our summers at her folks' place in East Hampton. That's where she wanted to be.
You miss her?
I left that long pause in there because he doesn't ever answer it, because it's almost like that question doesn't compute. He's like, do I miss her? Although he's been having these little fantasies and memories and recall, and that's the first time he actually remembers her out loud to a non-family member. And when he's asked, do you miss her? He's like, and it just goes on. It's almost like he just didn't hear it. It's a subjective hearing, because I guess he doesn't know how to process it.
Exactly. And at the same time, he is like, when he's talking about her, he's seeing visions of her around in different ways, and he's not really connecting that's his loss or missing her.
The one, there's not a lot of relationship aside from, we have Davis and the in-laws. That's mm-hmm. a relationship thing. Then mm-hmm. he kind of strikes up this relationship with the Champion Vending Machine. I wish I could remember her name, but
Karen in the movie.
Karen. Okay, so he strikes up a relationship with Karen, and she's got a kid. And it struck me as really interesting. He goes over there, and he's not doing anything in particular, but he sits down to dinner with the family, and the kid, it must be like 12, 13, some maybe 14.
I think she said he's 15.
15.
Yeah.
Oh, that's right. 15 years old.
He looks younger.
Yeah, he's smaller. Yeah. Not a big kid. And here's the way this conversation goes.
Did you have a good day? 26% of the registered voters. Enjoy your little vacay. Come on, lighten up. Tell me what you did today. Did you hang out with that cute girl? The one with the high-waisted jeans? No, not everyone can pull that look off. Are you for real right now? Spoke with your principal, Miss Turgeon. I found her to be very thoughtful and empathetic. Good news is she's letting you come back starting Monday. You have to spend a few weeks with the counselor, but I think you're getting off pretty easy.
What's the bad news?
What do you mean?
The hell are you talking about? There's some random guy eating in our house while your boyfriend slash boss is out of town, and you're bragging to me about a heart to heart you have with my, principal?
Can you just... Okay? Give me a break. Davis is a friend of mine. We've been spending time together, because that's what friends do. You spend time.
You're so transparent.
The man's wife just died. Have some compassion, you little shit. I'm sorry.
Your wife just died?
Yeah.
How?
Massive head trauma, car accident. Can you pass this off?
He's able to say the facts. He's able to say, this is what happened to my wife, massive head trauma. Okay, passed the salt. And but the reason I especially liked this clip was because it shows, it's almost like the kid, the emperor has no clothes, mom's all trying to act normal. And he's like, mm-hmm. What the hell are you doing? You're talking to me about my principal. I got some strange dude sitting at the table with me. And I think families kind of work like that, where we have, a lot of people who buzz around, who may not say things or comment on mm-hmm. how odd situations are. And oftentimes you have one family member who I would call him the truth teller, who's like, the emperor has no clothes. Why are we? He said, are you for real right now? And it just struck me as a true relationship dynamic and how families work or don't work when we're trying to ignore or acknowledge, you know, some significant fact. And here in this case, it was the kid who points out how weird this whole situation is.
Absolutely. And I think, you know, calling them the truth teller, right? I think everybody's got one. And sometimes the truth teller doesn't always speak up, but they know that that's who they are in the family, and they go, man, what the heck is going on here? And they just take it in, they'll answer the questions, and then they'll get out of the situation. Because they just don't want to, sometimes they just don't want to bother, because you know that if you're the truth teller, somebody might not be willing to hear the truth.
Most of the people, they don't want to talk about it.
Right, right. And just like she did, she went straight into, well, we're friends. And like, the kid is, you know, also acknowledging that this guy slept over. And whether mom and him did anything or not, the kid's like, what are you doing, mom? There's nothing normal about this scene right now.
Yeah, I'm commenting on the fact that this is weird. And
yes.
You're trying to tell me it's normal, and it's not. This is weird. So, and then they kind of strike up an interesting relationship because Davis supposedly has adopted the motto of, I'm just going to say the truth all the time now. I'm going to say things how it is. But the fact is, he doesn't see things clearly. He'll say his truth, right? I don't love my wife. I never love my wife. All this stuff. But we all look at it and go, well, that's your truth. It's not the objective truth. And so he and this kid get in a conversation, you know, about talking and telling the truth all the time. And so they kind of join together because the kid is kind of destructive and Davis is at a destructive part in his life. And so Davis drags this kid into this really short clip about they're just going to town on the house and ripping it apart.
What are we doing again?
We're taking apart my marriage.
For Davis, the house is the metaphor for his marriage, right? And if he's going to, and he can't take his wife apart and pick apart their relationship. So he's going to pick apart the house literally piece by piece. And even earlier in the movie, it's referred to as it's just shiny things because it's this pristine, beautiful glass and white marble type of finished house. And he rips it to shreds. That pulling it of it apart, again, feels like he's trying to see, is he going to feel anything when he's doing this? Or he's going to feel very extreme demolishing this life that they built together because she's gone.
There's something about breaking things or demolishing things. I remember my mom, who was a therapist too, still is, and she was in her education. And she said, you know what? It just helps to, what we're going to do is we're going to create an experience where we get to break things and just kind of this vent, this cathartic event. And so what they designed was a box, a cardboard box, and you know, they're very organized people. And so what they did was they put a trash bag in the middle of the cardboard box, and then at the bottom of the cardboard box, they put a rock, okay, or like a stepping stone, a little flat, hard surface. And they bought these, you know, 99-cent glasses. And so I still remember to this day them standing in the backyard and they're kind of generating this, and they throw the glasses in there and they break. But what happened was because, you know, I don't know if they had safety goggles. Let's say they had safety goggles. And they would try to throw these little glasses in and make sure that all the glass was contained in this little box. But they would hit the edge of the bag and then it would flip out and crash somewhere else. And so instead of doing this catharsis, breaking things, it's turned into this laugh fest because they couldn't for the life of them throw a glass in a box and break it. It would somehow go to this other catastrophe, and which I guess in hindsight, they didn't get the catharsis from breaking things. They got it from laughing so hard together.
And that's a great story, and it's making me remember also there's a place here, and I don't know if it became a chain, but the one that was here went away, but it was a place I think it was called the Smash Shack, and people could bring plates, or you could buy cheap plates there, and you get put in a room with goggles, and you had your own isolated little booth, and you could throw the plate and just smash it, and it was allowed. People would come to be able to just kind of get their aggressions out, and it was called the Smash Shack, and people, I remembered it was on the local news when it opened up, and people would just smash things. You could bring in stuff if you wanted to, if you had trinkets from relationships that you wanted to smash. I've gone gun shooting with a bunch of guys years ago, and the guys were bringing teddy bears and things that their ex-girlfriends had given them, and they put them out in the woods and shoot at them. I mean, people get pleasure from destroying things and destructing things. You know, we learn when we're little kids, here, punch a pillow, right? Don't punch the wall, don't punch your brother, but go punch a pillow when you're angry, right? So we get taught those lessons that you have to get your aggression out somehow. And those kind of things, like your mom in the glasses, that's pretty funny, right? There's turned to laughing. And I suspect if you stand there and you go to the Smash Shack and you throw your plate at some point, like I would think 2-3 plates in, unless you are just really got a lot of anger, you're probably going to be feeling like it's more fun than it is like angry destruction. And I know that the gun shooting was a lot of fun too when it came down to it, when you could see who could hit the teddy bear. But
or even like just shooting a watermelon, or
right,
you know, taking a boxing class. And there's something,
yes,
about that, those endorphins that get released that actually make you feel better through this physical exertion or this stressor that taxes your body. And so whatever way it is, as long as it's not, to me, Davis in our movie does it the worst possible way. He has no understanding or insight. He says, I'm breaking down my house because I'm trying to dismantle my marriage. But I think in those other situations, like you and I have talked about just a few seconds ago, we know what we're doing. We're getting something out.
I think the big point that you've said here is the insight. And that's where when people take action without insight, they end up doing themselves more harm than good most of the time. And even when people compartmentalize, right? A true compartmentalizing is an automatic behavior. But there are people out there that go, you know what? This makes me uncomfortable, so I don't want to think about it, so I'm not going to. So they purposefully try and put it away. And that often leads to a lot more cognitive dissonance, because they're not trying to deal with something that they need to deal with. And it wasn't an automatic behavior. They're just saying, I'm just not going to deal with it. Davis has no insight, as you said. So he's destroying his entire home, and he's pretty much lost his job, or you get referenced that you think he's going to lose his job from his father-in-law. So like his whole life is being demolished. I mean, the whole movie is this metaphor of demolition. So I think so importantly that if you're feeling like you need to break something apart, ask yourself why you're really doing it, and then check with someone.
Yeah.
don't take a bulldozer to your house without checking with like five of your good friends and saying, do you guys agree that this is a good move? Is this how I'm really going to deal with my emotions right now? And if any of them say yes, then you should not be friends with them. But
reject them as friends. Some of the best advice that I think my partner at work got after her son passed away was really don't make any giant decisions for the next year, 2 years. Like, don't quit your job. Don't sell your house. Don't, you know, move out of state. But people do that. And I think they do it as a way of reaction. Like there was a gal around here who was commuting or carpooling with a bunch of kids for a game or school or something. And she went off the road and all the kids died and she lived. So there was like four, like they were under 10 little girls who all died. And one of the things that she did was she moved out of state right away. And that may have been good for her. I don't know. But I know what she was doing was she's like, everywhere I drive, everywhere I go, I remember everything. And so maybe it was a good thing. But I think in general, people should refrain from making huge decisions when they're going through, well, they're still in that shock stage of a grief or a loss or a transition. You know, you should really try to, you got to evaluate. I mean, sometimes you have to, like you lose your job, you can't maintain your mortgage, you know, you can't maintain your same state of living, and you have to, you know, make some moves around that. But the ones that you have choice over, you should really do a lot of evaluation before you make big decisions after going through a recent trauma.
You know, they call that doing a geographic, you know, and when a lot of times that comes up in recovery work where people will move to a different state or something like that, and they just say, you know, like your problem's going to come with you anyway.
No matter where you go, there you are, right? I mean, you can't run from yourself.
Right. And that's the thing. If you're making the move out of avoidance, the situation you just painted was so extreme of this woman and the kids in the car. So I don't know that I would tell her any different necessarily. But in like Davis's case, he had no part of it. And if you're looking to avoid the situation, that's where I'd go with people. If you're looking to avoid something by moving and running away from it, it's probably like, I wonder what would happen for you growth-wise if you sat with that feeling and sat with the pain and sat with the emotions and sat with the shame or the guilt or the what ifs or the regrets and processed that for a while before you made your decision to go.
Yeah, I think if you move away, we'll just take that example. If you move away, it doesn't give you the opportunity to resolve it. That will never be resolved. That situation, which of course, you know, in the death of children and other people's children, I get it. But, you know, in any other circumstance, like if you embarrass yourself in some setting and then never go back to that setting again, that will be the last memory you have of that setting, and it won't be a good one. You don't have a chance to resolve it or go make amends or figure out what you can do so you can kind of put this trauma or stress or bad situation to rest in your head. You just, that'll always be something that's undone and you have no way of resolving it. I think in AA, you know, making amends, you know, after you've hurt somebody, you got to make amends to the people who you've hurt. Now, sometimes there are people who aren't alive or aren't in your life, and it would be absurd to try to seek them out. But you have to figure out for each one of those situations, how do you put it to rest? How do you resolve it so that when you think of that event and that situation or that person again, you're able to say, and I also made an amends for that situation. So that helps you resolve it. That helps you put it to rest. So we can't stay in denial the whole time, right? Eventually, please, in this hour and a half movie, we have to have Davis have some insight and understanding. And maybe you can help me remember, but did he think that his wife was having an affair at some point?
Yes. It was confirmed that she was. She was, in fact, pregnant. So Davis found a sonogram picture showing that she was pregnant, and there was this fundraiser in her honor at the in-laws' house, and that's where he went in this grand gesture to confront the parents about, did you know this? And then the mother-in-law says, yes, because it wasn't yours, and she took her to get the procedure, meaning she got the abortion, and then says, and I wish she kept the baby. Because, of course, at that point, then they'd still have the living semblance of her and the grandchild. So, yeah, so there was this little offshoot moment of him also processing. And then for him waking up, too, and going, oh, my God, why would my wife not tell me she was pregnant? It never even occurred to him that she was having an affair. And she was. We're going to another scene because there's confusion over who this new person is that's been following Davis throughout the movie.
Yeah, and initially he thinks it's this affair guy, and we come to find out who it really is.
What's your name?
Michael.
I know about everything, Michael.
It's okay.
I just hope that you cared for her. She deserved that.
I don't know what you're talking about. I was in the other car. I was driving the car that hit you. And I've been trying. I'm sorry.
It's okay.
I'm so sorry.
It's okay.
Davis gets in the car. He's looking at a note from his wife.
Not my chair, not my problems, have you seen?
And finally, we have tears.
Mm-hmm.
It took the grief of someone who didn't know his wife to bring those feelings out of him. I don't know if it gave him permission or just kind of gave him a model of what it was. But here was a guy who was grief-stricken by the fact that he actually killed somebody else, and he couldn't resolve it. They met at the tombstone, at her headstone, and you know there are these two men there for different reasons. One is I killed your wife. The other one is my wife is dead, and the one who killed the wife has more grief than the husband who lost his life partner forever. So I think that's maybe what turned the corner for Davis. You know, sometimes people are more distraught than the people who you would think that they would be less distraught because of the loss, and other people act more distraught. You're like, wow, that's kind of an overreaction. You just met this person and you're more distraught than, you know, someone who's significant in their life. But like we talked about, everybody grieves differently.
Right. It was almost as if he was mirroring the pain that Davis was not in touch with. So when they were face to face at her headstone, and he had been following him around, Davis had noticed a station wagon following him throughout the movie. He didn't know why someone was after him, is the way he was putting it. And so to meet up with him there, it's as if he was mirroring the pain that Davis had not let himself feel. And when he gets away from him, he's still carrying that. Now it's fresh. He sits in the car. He starts crying. And from there, there's that cathartic moment where then he really goes into like feeling and we'll say acceptance or acknowledgement and starts to resolve the fact that he loved his wife. He lost her. It's painful. And then he gets back in good graces with his in-laws, and they do something to signify and memorialize her in a way where he wants to even, it becomes grander than how her parents had even imagined it, and everything becomes all hunky-dory again, and everybody like is mourning and loving her together.
Yeah, they're actually going through the grief together.
Right, instead of all these separated personalities who don't know how to make sense of what just happened to their lives.
Yeah, and the reason that last scene was a big twist for me is I had not once thought of the person who hit them. That was a new character. I didn't even, through the whole time, I didn't even think about it. But then that first reaction, and even when he finds out when Davis finds out who this guy is, who's putting flowers on his wife's tombstone, he is pretty quick to let him off the hook. He didn't turn around and get mad. Why aren't you paying attention? What happened? He didn't do that grief, that anger acting out like some people might. But it's interesting to me that what he's relieved of, and what I'm sure the driver was relieved of too, which is there aren't these people out there that hate me as much as I hate myself for doing what I did. And now, you know, I'm going to have to deal with their scorn and their disapproval. But on Davis's side, relieving or not holding this grudge helps him. And that's what I always try to do whatever I can to let go of a grudge, because it doesn't hurt the other person and it only ruins my day. So I do what I can to possibly make amends or to make resolution with those who have harmed me instead of hating them, because it takes a lot of energy to hate people who harm me. And then that just gives them power over my life. I'm not perfect at it, but that's my goal always, is to how do I release that energy I have towards them, because it doesn't make me feel good. It doesn't make them feel bad, but it doesn't make me feel good at all.
Oh, no. And it, as you said, it ruins your day, takes you down. And for me, I like to kind of think about, well, this is a process that person's going through, and it really has nothing to do with me. You know, because anytime somebody really gets at you under your skin, it usually has more to do with what they're projecting onto you and what you're receiving and don't want to feel. I mean, unless you've deliberately done something to somebody, most of the time when someone is mad at you, there's something they don't want to see in themselves. If they're holding some kind of grudge against you, if you're feeling like, man, I'm so mad, how could they do this to me? If sometimes if we can just twist it up, I like to twist it up and look at, I wonder what they're going through. I wonder what their motivation is for turning that way on me.
Yeah, but I don't want to understand them. They're the jerk.
But right, but if you can understand them, you can let go of all that anger and go, oh, I get it. This is all about them. And this is something that they're projecting onto me. And I really didn't have anything to do with their issue. I really didn't do anything, you know?
But how could that even be possible if I'm the center of the world? Everything that somebody else has to do all affects me, right? Isn't that how it works?
That is right on most days, Courtney. But
but not today.
I'm sure your wife would tell you that, right?
Well,
you are the
my
center
wife would
of the
tell
world.
Me, yeah, it's definitely not always about me. So, but
that's what happens. We can trip into this idea that I did something, and you absorb what people put on you, or absorb their body language, absorb their nonverbals that they're giving you, or their verbals. Maybe they say, I just don't want to be around you today. And you go, oh my God, what did I do? And you start going, how could they treat me like that? How come this hurts me so badly? And then you go, wait a minute. What on earth are they going through that would make them think that? And then you go, oh, I can get it. I can understand. This is about their process in this situation. It has nothing to do with me. And I can let go of that then and get on with my day. And it really doesn't affect me.
And that's the benefit of having a confidant, a friend, a relative who you can talk to and go, all right, here's everything that's going on. What am I not seeing? You know, was I really a jerk? I didn't think I was being a jerk. I wasn't trying to be a jerk, but maybe after I tell you, you can point it out and say, oh yeah, see why they had this expectation and you failed it. And then they thought you were just being totally selfish about it. And you're like, ah. And it, sometimes for like, if, when someone says something that's totally out of the blue to me about help me understand a situation differently, it takes me probably a day or two for it to kind of brew or steep or, you know, kind of crock pot in me before I can change my perspective. And sometimes it's that little bit of insight from an outsider, from someone who's not in the situation, who can be totally honest with me, is enough to help me kind of tweak the situation and make me feel differently about it.
Oh, sure. And I think it's important that, you know, people who are not just going to yes you to death, because there's a lot of people out there that when you pull in your, whenever I have clients, I'll be like, okay, well, what did your three best girlfriends say about that? And then they'll tell me, and then I'll say, and how many of them would tell you whatever it is that you needed to hear in that moment? And then it's like two out of three will. I say, so what's the one that will tell you the truth? What does she really say? And you pull it apart by how you said, you know, who will really tell you the truth? Because everybody's got their little set of cronies that will tell them whatever it is they think they want to hear. But then you want the people that will tell you how it really is.
Yeah, if you want to do something different. Like, yes. It's kind of like the way when I was in high school, I would select my music. If I was going through a breakup, I would select music that, okay, I'm mad and I want to be mad at this person. Play this music. Or I'm mad at this person and I want to get through it and I want to come to a resolve and feel better about it. Play this music. So it's the same thing, only you're kind of doing it with your friends. But let's tell people before we sign off how they can find all the Shrink to Shrink episodes and interact with us.
Well, we are on iTunes and Libsyn, Shrink to Shrink with the number two in between. And we also do have a website with little blog posts with show notes that go up with every episode, and that's shrinktoshrink.com. And our episodes come out at the last day of the month. I'm also at coachingthroughchaos.com, and you can find me on Twitter at Dr. Colleen Mullen. And Courtney, you are at QuadFatherMFT on Twitter, and can also find us both on the Coaching Through Chaos podcast. And Courtney hosts the Quadcast podcast.
It stumbles you. I get it. It's not easy to say. It's a tongue twister. Quadcast podcast. So yeah, and we come out again, like you said, at the last day of every month. And next time, we promise not to do all grief and all sadness. But
no, I think we should find a nice comedy again to do. Those are always a little lighter and fun.
Yeah, like the train wreck and Other fun, fun. I don't know that we need to go animated, but we'll see. We'll see. Whatever pops up as coming out new and is interesting to talk about, we will be talking about it and analyzing it.
And you know, there's so many good movies that are out in movie theaters right now. I can't wait for like probably November, December. We're going to have like our pick of like such cool movies out there. But if anybody's listening, you know, if you like what you're hearing and you want to shout out to us movies that you think we should talk about, we'd love to hear from you too. So the easiest way to get us is on Twitter. Just give us a little shout out on Twitter. Let us know what you want to hear. We're also at Shrink2Shrink on Twitter as well. So we're all over the place.
And we promise not to charge you for the interaction. Just like you're not charging me for this interaction, right? I don't have to pay you on my way out, do I, Doc?
No, this one's a freebie, Courtney.
Yes.
I like with every like three sessions, you get one free.
I got a coupon. Does that help? All right. So until next time, we will save a seat on the movie couch for you, and we'll see you next time. See you, Colleen.
See you, Courtney.